Welcome viewers, this is Literary Goa, the program that looks at authors and books from Goa and about Goa. Today we have with us Maria de Lourdes Bravo da Costa Rodriguez. I know her for so long that I know her full name. And we were just joking 2 minutes back when I asked her, how many books have you written? So she started counting. So I said, you need to count your children, there are so many of them. So she's going to tell us about how many there are. Lourdes, you start with?
Yeah. I would say that if I take into consideration my first writing, which I did along with Mario Cabralisa.
The journalist, Mario Cabralisa.
Yeah, the journalist. I did the research for him and some writing of some parts of the book, like the footnotes and the bibliography and the introduction of each of the person we have included in the biography. I have those four volumes we had, four volumes at different point of time. But I would say that my book would be, the first attempt of mine would be Desti Morsels.
So the total of your books are total in 11 plus 4, sorry, 7
no,
plus 4.
7 plus 4.
So that makes it 11.
Yeah.
No, but see, with Mario's titles, Great Goans, he has given you full credit as a co-author. It says Mario Cabralisa and Lourdes Bravo da Costa Rodriguez.
Yes.
And it was a very, of course, he was a very prominent journalist. Unfortunately, he's elderly now, so he doesn't write.
Right.
But he was a big name in journalism. And the series also was much appreciated because it focuses, there were four books focusing each on four great Goans.
Correct.
Tell us about it, how it came about, when it came about. In those days, Goa books were very few to find with, especially in English.
Yeah, and it came in the 80s when he came to me, said, would you like to work? And I didn't let the opportunity, you know, get away from me. And I accepted the challenge. And I started working with Desti. He was a well-known journalist. I was just starting my career in Indo-Portuguese history as a librarian and otherwise also writing. So I said I will not lose the opportunity, and I started working with him. I think I was born to write.
but of course, working with Mario is quite an opportunity because he pushes you. I knew
as
a junior.
Was very demanding. This is not only the work that I've done with him, but otherwise also when he had edited works, I have contributed for the books.
And not only that, his writing style was very catchy and attractive, in that sense.
In fact, I used to read Mario from my age 13 when
I
was
Portuguese?
In school.
In Portuguese?
No. He wrote in English, and I used to read Mario from that time, always read his columns.
So before we get distracted, of course, Mario is a prominent name and it always, you know, one of our friends. But tell us the four books, which great Goans do they focus on, each book, more or less?
Each book, the first book he went to Abad de Faria and Lata Mangeshkar, and then we have Tristan Braganza Cunha, and we have also Paz de Vaz, the four of them. Then the others, we had Francis Luis Gomes, we had Luis Jimenez Braganza.
Didi Kosambi, Dharmanand Kosambi?
Yeah, them, both the father and the son too. We did them also.
I remember it was quite an eye-opener for us because we were young and books on Goa were hard to come by in the 80s.
True.
And this had a very nice mix of, you know, a broad section of Goans across the centuries, across religious cultures.
It was difficult to decide whom to include. Because all Goans feel that we are all great. So it was a little bit...
And there are quite a few. There are quite a few number of achievers in that sense, no?
So that's what led him to decide. He did the selection. I only gave him the list and then he selected. Like Madhav Mantri, for example. Nobody knew about Madhav Mantri. Madhav Mantri was the minister...
Minister to some foreign kingdom, no?
Yes, right. So the Karnataka kingdom.
Pre-Portuguese or Portuguese?
Pre-Portuguese.
Pre-Portuguese.
Yeah. And so he decided whom to select. The last volume had more than four. We had six biographies in that volume.
I thought it was a perfect marriage in the sense that, he was a journalist who had the writing skills and you knew all the kind of, you know, information that was in the library. Because for those who don't know, you've been a librarian all your life. And everyone in Panjim who visited Central Library had to meet Lourdes in that sense. How did you make this shift from being a librarian to being, someone deeply interested in history, writing academic history papers, now on the verge of doing your PhD in history? How did you make this shift? And also writing so much.
Yeah. See, when I joined Central Library in 1981, Mr. V.B. Hubli, the curator, he created an independent section called the Rare Books and Local History section. And I was put in charge of the section because of my knowledge of Portuguese language, and he thought that I would be able to manage well the section. So when after I said, okay, I'm in charge of local history, I did my bachelor in library science. And coming back from Bombay, I said, let me join and do my master's in history. Basically, I'm a science graduate.
I see.
Yeah, so I changed the faculty, answered the exams, and did my master's in history. All 8 papers, because if I had taken a combination of history and sociology, I wouldn't be able to do Goa history. And then I said, if I'm doing history, I have to do because of Goa history. So that's how I did my MA in entire history, 8 papers. I had the Goa paper. And the liking with the readers coming, the old generation wanting to write about Goa, discuss Goa, historians, so-called historians, doctors, journalists. You know, we had all kind of people coming in.
Yeah.
You might have not been able to meet them, unfortunately. But it was a nice opportunity.
It was a meeting place, no?
Exactly.
Everyone who was studying Goa.
Correct.
For the rare books and Goa book section.
Correct. And to tell you the fact, in that library of ours, in the old building, that is where...
Very close to us here, next
correct,
to the police headquarters.
Where the Institute of Ministry Braganza functions now.
Yeah.
We had so many people coming to do research on Goa. We had several PhDs. We had, of course, students of MA. And we have to give credit to our students of MA at that point of time, that when Professor George Moraes was the head of department of the history department in the postgraduate center, he introduced one paper by research. So all the students had to do.
I see.
Yes. So that's how even the collection was built. You know, started building, have separate collection for Goa history. And then we decided to have this altogether independent section. So that was how the foundation was laid for this section. But people in the States who are in history field knows the Central Library. Some people in Australia, Portugal, obviously, we had people from Spain, we had people from Italy, we had from Vietnam.
Really?
Yes, yes. I remember his name, Patan Apong.
There are some Vietnamese records here?
No.
No.
He was studying for a doctorate on Indo-Portuguese history.
I see.
And I remember him bringing even a small dictionary of Portuguese, English.
I see.
Yeah. His name was Patan Apong. And he must have, after that I never met him. We had people from Japan coming to us.
I see.
People in Japan who spoke Konkani, learned Konkani, at least two
Professor
of them.
Professor Giri Suzuki and
Suzuki
our friend.
Kyoko. Now Suzuki came before Kyoko. Then I put Suzuki and Kyoko together.
I see.
Yeah. And then when Suzuki died, it was Kyoko who wrote to me that Suzuki died.
Yeah.
Yeah, unfortunately, I died young.
Which I learned very recently.
Yeah, yeah.
So you like history?
I like history now.
Yeah.
It's an irony of fate. I mean, I never liked history, but I started, because history at a higher level is something different from what you study in school.
Also, the way they teach it makes it boring, no?
Correct.
I think there are so many interesting facts there. Like, say, even if you want to understand Goa from a historical perspective, it's fascinating the kind of empires that came to Goa, the kind of things that Goans achieved all over the world. That we don't really study in that sense. So.
No. You are just telling the dates and who came and who went. You know, not there's no analysis, which today we go in for analysis. There's a trend now to study micro topics rather than macro, especially for research.
I see.
And I have been doing that because I like to do. As you know, I have also been columnist for local papers and magazines too. I've just stopped of late because of my doctorate, because my guy doesn't accept it. You know, you write there in a different style, and then the academic style is different, and I agree with him.
Of course, we'll come to your doctorate, which is also interesting,
so,
about Goan food and things like that. But first, on your books. So after Great Goans came
And then we have Tasty Morsels. This is a book on food. This is the second edition.
Two parts of Tasty Morsels.
Not two parts. This is the first original book, and this is the second edition of Tasty Goan Morsel. And the reason I published this book is that I had done research on culinary art. So I said, I have to publish it. And then academics don't sell.
Right.
That's why half of the book is for recipes and the other half is for the theoretical part.
I see.
Yeah.
I see. So but I must appreciate the fact that, you know, you've been pushing and working on your own books, which is a very difficult field. It's not very easy. And making, you know, writing a book is one thing, but making it viable is quite different. So, of course, there's a lot of interest in food and you rightly perceived it. So half of these are recipes?
Yes.
Like what?
Goan food recipes, like you'll have the usual, the shakuti, the sarapatel, the kabidel. But then the history also connected to these dishes is also a part of the book.
Very interesting.
Separately.
Of course, I have this book in my collection, but I wonder how many readers have you know, actually come
across.
We
are sold out now.
Oh, I see.
The third order, they are waiting for the last 3 years. I have no time to sit because I want to have another edition.
Okay. Yeah. Food is a very popular topic in that sense in Goa, much appreciated. After these two came?
After this one, then I did my book on memoirs, Remembering Goa.
This was
my column in the Herald.
Okay.
So this was also by twist of fate, you see. I had dropped in Herald one day and I was talking to Ethel.
Yeah,
the cost. And I was talking to her and telling about Goa, how it is, and this and that, and so many things. I said, why don't you write down?
I see.
Come on, you write and I will publish your memoirs. She put the title as memoirs, and some people said, at that point of time, you were too young to write memoirs. I said, I didn't give the title. She gave an excerpt. So people started reading my column. There are people, well-placed people who read the column and ask me, how come you remember? Or Mario Miranda, for example, always say, why? I appreciate what you're doing. I look forward to read your column.
I see.
And I remember the comment of Dr. Zé Conceição Almeida, who was our
Almeida,
right? And he came to me and says, come, you remember minutely all those.
So you have a good memory.
For events.
Yeah, I still have. Yeah.
I can remember since my age 3, 4.
Really?
Yes. Really. So I said how, and getting a compliment from J.C. Almeida is not easy. I know him very well. It's not easy.
I see.
But anyway.
Of course, the other thing, Lourdes, is that in those days, you know, because of the change in regime and 61 and the bad blood with which it happened, people mostly didn't want to talk about these things, so they were swept under the carpet. And there was a huge interest among that generation who lived in those times to get to know these things also. Now, I think Professor Vasco Pino has written on a similar vein, and a few others have written about the Goa that was, and you know.
Correct.
And I think memories are important in that sense. So this is Remembering Goa, your columns.
Yeah.
And it looks back to which period of Goa?
50s, sometimes little earlier also, but mostly 50s, what I could remember. I'm not that old also, it's the 50s
Or what people told you or family or what you picked up.
Yeah, what they told. And if I needed something, I would back up with records and newspapers and all that kind of thing, books and all that. I mean, I used to document them. If I was wrong, I would go and check and write.
And you were sitting with all the information, so finding the information was...
Yeah, people feel that if you sit with the information, you can become a writer. I don't agree with
that. Yeah, of course. Yeah. But you can at least get your references right.
Exactly.
And, you know,
exactly.
In that
you, have a, you have, a, what do you say, a weapon in your hand.
Yeah.
No doubt. But you must know how to use it.
But these are all very different media. Like, for example, if I'm a lecturer, I need not write well. If I'm a writer, I need not talk well.
Correct.
You know, if I'm a good reader, I need not, you know, also be able to write or something. They are different.
True.
And to bridge that, that's a challenge. One book which I really liked a lot of yours was The Games We Played.
Yes.
Traditional Goan Sports. Okay.
Right.
The Games We Played. Traditional.
This is the last book. I have not gone ahead. I'm still playing with the game.
but having said that, it's a very thin book. It costs just 99 rupees.
Yeah.
That's just not even, you know, 3-digit figure.
Correct.
But what I like about it is that it has Alexei's cartoons, of course.
Yes.
And also it has descriptions of all the games that were played in Goa, which even in our generation we have forgotten over time.
Correct.
Like I remember cajou seeds as a kid, but then it just vanished.
You don't. Now cajous have come so expensive, nobody wants to play the seeds.
Marbles, for example.
Yeah.
And each game had its own season, no? Gilli Danda.
Temporal. Like rainy season, we had the marbles.
Yeah.
No, cajous also, but marbles because we had to make the meal.
Yeah.
So the meal, the
round, had to be soft. The round hole.
Yeah, it had to be soft, so you had to put your foot on it and then turn.
Yeah.
You know, there were all techniques that were there.
Yeah.
It was not an easy game. There was
a lot of science
game. Yeah. Maybe there were no instruments or toys or things that you would use.
Yeah.
Except for the marbles. But other things you knew how to make.
Yeah.
Those, the elders among the kids, knew how to bully them. So they knew, you know, if
how
there is
cheat.
Some, yes, if there is some sort of inclination,
angle, yeah.
the marble would go into easily.
So there were a lot of techniques. There were a lot of
techniques
in those days.
Yes.
It was not. It was so. While the implements and the tools may have been few, there was a lot of skill that was involved.
Correct.
Apart from that, Gilli Danda, what they used to call Baltonko in Goa,
yeah,
that is vanished.
Goindobal.
Goindobal, correct.
Goindobal, yeah.
That is completely vanished. Not to talk about tabla, which I've just heard about tabla,
yes.
And I never seen it being played. I've seen photographs of it, one or two.
Okay.
I don't know the rules in that sense.
Yeah, there are rules for that, the tabla, but it's more the skill than the rules. It's because the skill of throwing the tablans and holding them and then throwing them. Even in throwing the tablans, there was a skill to get all the, you know, colors on one side. Because you will get more points.
I see.
Yeah.
So, does anyone make these things nowadays? No.
No, they make, but Mahendra Alves has started a competition of tablans in
really?
Lutuli. Yes.
So, has your book spearheaded some of these initiatives? Because I know they are talking about organizing traditional games competitions,
yes,
in the various villages.
Correct.
Do you feel your book has contributed to it? Has anyone given you feedback?
Think
I'm
so,
sure. I'm sure.
Yeah, it has. I think it has.
So you are talking here about outdoor games and indoor games.
Correct.
And indoor games, you break it up into card games, board games, pretending games. What's that?
Presenting
games. Pretending.
Pretending. How is hide and seek?
Yeah.
You're pretending that you're hiding.
Wedding ceremony.
Yeah, wedding ceremony.
The young girls like to play that.
Correct. Then how to cook. There's also the pretend.
School, doctor, and police store and
correct,
store police, whatever.
Yeah.
And of course, indoor games, like some other indoor games and
like
chasing
very,
games.
Like very well known was amongst the ladies and girls was the five stones, to throw them and then throw one up and then.
What was it called?
Paanch Satrani,
yeah.
Five stones. Yeah.
So they made do with the minimum that was there.
Yes.
In that sense.
People knew how to make use of what was available around them.
I even remember.
It was environmentally friendly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
what local resources? You didn't have to go to buy, waste your money.
Exactly. Just the round, nice five stones.
Yeah.
You know, polished ones. They would select the stones. Even in that selection, they knew how to select. All that worked.
Even your cajou seeds to select,
yeah,
they would say aiming seed, the botto,
yeah,
as you call
botto.
It. Is a big one and it's
correct.
Made in a particular shape and
yes.
It is a bit rubbery.
Correct.
So it'll bounce back.
Bounce, yeah.
But I thought this book was, you know, it's a simple book, it's a modest book, but it's very practical and it has the ability to also revive, you know,
yeah,
our traditions.
The memories and nostalgia, yes.
Then we go to these
I've done
two.
Also festivals and observances of Goa.
Okay. Tell us about it.
Yeah, this book was done because I felt the need for the student community. Because many students to come and they were asking about festivals and the
for
fees.
For assignments?
Assignment. So I said, why not put together?
I see.
Yeah, and then I worked on this. This I worked in some 6 months, I think, the book.
You mean 6 months is a short time or a long time? What's your average
time? It is
time?
Short time.
Short time.
Yeah, six
short
months
time.
Short time.
What's the average time for doing a book?
Oh, you see, then there is the collection of material,
it takes time,
working
no?
on it, editing, and a lot of
very time consuming to make sure there are no
correct,
errors.
Correct. Or if you have a deadline, like how I pushed for this book, I said, no, it must come by 18th of December. That's then it is a different issue.
So you're talking about all the festivals in Goa, Hindu, Catholic festivals, and Muslim festivals.
Correct. Not all.
Okay.
It's a selective. You can't have all.
Yeah. There are too many.
Too many.
If you see the calendar, the Panchang every year.
You could have an encyclopedia of festivals of Goa.
Yeah, true. And then
I was asked by when Goa Chamber of Commerce and Industry completed 100 years, you know, they asked me to write on the history of Goa Chamber of Commerce and Industry, or at what was then a Camera de Comércio, you know. So I took the challenge. I said, why not? I have a full book now. It's not just essays that I'm putting together.
Yeah.
And
you had to dig up all the history?
Yes. I had to dig up the history. And I remember when they told me, will you be ready to give in 2 months' time? I said, you don't understand what is writing a book is.
I'm glad you said it, because yeah. people think that books are born in a jiffy, but there yeah. is a gestation period.
Or you copy paste and you have a book.
Yeah, there
like
is a gestation.
Many do. Yeah, yeah, I wouldn't say yeah. no, but many do that.
But there is a gestation, and the more bigger hurry you are in, the bigger chance of making mistakes and you know
exactly.
getting stuck in the process.
Yeah,
and it takes its own time.
At this, I had to do it alone, not only write the book, but get it printed, cover,
yeah.
the entire
design,
book
yeah,
design,
yeah.
everything.
Layout,
everything was done by
printing, the economics, everything.
So. They only made the payments, nothing else,
yeah,
the whole
yeah,
thing.
Yeah.
Then this, when they asked me to write,
yeah.
I always had in mind to use the advertisements in the newspapers to do some
They're so interesting,
work.
No? The ads are so interesting
Correct.
In that sense, because if you see the old papers,
Yes.
you come across very funny, odd, unusual, interesting ads from
right.
all over the world, products from Germany, Holland.
Yes.
You know, some guys advertising for almost snake oil, like some kind of remedies
yeah,
which
yeah,
are bizarre.
Different
like
kind, different kind of thing. So I said, when they asked me, I put across my proposal.
Yeah.
I said, since it is the Chamber's 100th anniversary, I will also like to have an exhibition.
Yeah. Of the ads?
Of the ads. And a catalog for that.
Yeah.
So they had okay, we'll show because they couldn't understand
okay.
what it was.
Okay.
So we had a professional presentation. You know, the my friend Babur had exhibit the boards done professionally. I came then with the photographs which Olain Sukutin of Hollywood.
Yeah.
He came. So the projection, everything was done professionally. And a closed room.
I see.
Because I said, if you don't agree, you should not go out of the idea.
I see.
And they immediately agreed. No, so they
I
go
see.
Ahead.
I see.
And we had exhibition. I had twice the exhibition.
I
in
see.
Fact, once with the chamber. Second time I had it from the Saurian. And Paul Varela, when I proposed it, he was, he said immediately yes. And then he told me why.
Yeah, yeah,
there was
yeah.
there's one advertisement here
yeah.
of the Brandy Constantino, I think it was.
I see.
And of course, the nostalgia of Paul Varela Gomez also. Yeah, this Brandy Constantino,
yeah, yeah,
this
yeah.
advertisement,
yeah.
he remembered nostalgically of the time when at Rocio in Lisbon, there was this carriage with the wheels moving and lights
I
and
see.
All. And he as a child used to, was attracted to
it. The ad.
Yeah, to that. And he used to go to meet his mother.
Yeah.
And just to see that carriage over there.
I see.
Yeah.
When you talk about advertisements, there's a lot of history encoded in the ads also. No?
Yes,
because,
yes, lots of history.
It's telling you the story of the time. For example, in this section on automobiles,
yes.
you are talking about the cars that were
imported
to Goa, right? From the early days,
yes.
MSB Kakula importing
yes.
Ford Motor
Ford.
Company's cars yes. and all these kind of, you know, Austins and whatever it is. I remember even in the 60s, some were still available.
Yes.
Of course, you could not get parts for them. That was
correct,
another story.
Correct.
Chogle and CI.
They allowed
CR
them
Limitada.
To import whatever was already ordered and whatever was already paid for.
I see.
After that, import
61,
was stopped.
Yeah. So
yeah.
after a few years, they had a problem.
Yeah.
And you're talking about the kind of cars and models.
Correct.
And but
cycles,
but, yeah.
motorcycles.
Tell us about your research. We have some time for that.
Yeah. So that. Doing my doctorate was always in my mind. I attempted once, but there was no time and all that. Then after retirement, I said, why should not I do?
Yeah.
So let me do it. I was working for a guide, and Professor Dr. Remy Dias is one of the guys, and I went to him, and he was very happy that I came.
I
he probably was happy because he thought I would finish in no time, in a minimum 2 years, but it didn't happen.
Yeah.
I selected and said, what would you like to work on? I said, I would like to work on food history because that's my pet subject, food. So I said, okay. So
history
then,
of Goan food?
Yeah, history of Goan food, some important aspects of
I see,
Goan food.
I see.
And I hope it is, I think it's going in a right direction. There's quite a lot of interest in it. It's not like people, oh, you're working on food history, so you're going to give recipes and how to cook. Well, that's not
yeah,
what
yeah,
one
yeah.
Look forward in a PhD
at that level.
And it is, of course, you may add the preparation all if you required,
right?
You know, to explain what it is, but otherwise, it's more a different.
You
I have even literature for that matter in my thesis.
You are one of the few persons from the world of library science who has gone into becoming an author, and
yeah.
so many books are that. 11 children, as I kept saying. Tell us what's your advice to young people who want to write a book. Is it the easy, difficult? What are the challenges? What do they have to look out for?
See, I would tell the youngsters that what they need is first an aim, an objective to work and do something. For example, if they want to write, they have to focus on that. It's not just, not the copy-paste business. Because nowadays the youngsters feel that it's copy-paste and I have done the assignment. When I was looking at somebody's assignment at the library, I said, but you have taken this, downloaded. Yes, and your professor, no, they have accepted. How can a professor accept what is downloaded? And the student coolly just, and he says, no, we are taught that way.
Issues of copyright are a serious concern in
exactly.
That sense.
Not only copyright, how is the student going to learn?
Yeah.
You know, that's not the way we have been taught.
Some originality needs to be there.
Exactly. Some effort, using the mind to work, some analysis.
Yeah.
You know, but let's hope we have a better generation.
But you feel people are taking more interest in Goa studies or less interest nowadays?
Just today we're discussing how many of us are seriously working on Goa. First of all, I'll tell you, if you want to study contemporary history before 61, you have to know Portuguese language. There is no excuse for you not to know the language, because all the documents are in Portuguese. So you don't expect that Frederick will translate for me or Lourdes will translate for me and then I will write a chapter or the paper. You have to study, because I have seen during my career now from 80s onwards that the researchers learn the language. Patanapong, Vietnamese, new Portuguese.
People from outside Portuguese. Goa, from outside Goa.
Not only that, from Vietnam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And people, even other parts of India, they're
exactly.
showing.
Exactly.
They
make an
up.
Effort. Our students don't make an effort.
Yeah.
They don't want to learn. They say, no, it's in Portuguese. So what?
Which is a sad thing, because there's so much of our knowledge
so much.
Also.
I'm feeling so sad, because I don't know if we will have somebody to work on what we have. And then when we complain, when others come, that others come and they do history of Goa.
On that note, while it is not a very positive note, I think that, you know, everyone adds to the total of understanding Goa. And Lourdes, I'd like to appreciate all the work you've done and also thank you for coming here and spending time with our viewers on CCR TV. Thank you so much.
My pleasure to be with you and talk about my work. Thank I hope you. It helps the younger generation to work.
I'm sure something somewhere will touch a chord.